You don't want unforgiveness in your heart. You don't want to be at that place because it's too late. It's too late when that happens. The Bible says almost all things are by law purged with blood, but without the shedding of blood, there's no remissions of sin. When he shed his blood on that cross, it was for us. It was for our sins. And it was a personal thing to Jesus. When he hung on that cross, you were on his mind. It was personal to him. The cross calls us to die to ourselves. Then said Jesus to his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Now that's a big one. Denying yourself is a big one. Because most of us want our way. Most of us want it done the way we want it done. Most of us will offend someone because we want it our way, and we're settled that way. God says you've got to die to yourself. The cross will bring you to a place where you have to die too. You have to die to who you think you are. You have to be what God wants you to be. Then said Jesus, when he was hanging on that cross, he said, Father, forgive them. Why did he say that? Even hanging on that cross, it was about forgiveness. Even on the cross, the ones that walked by wagging their heads, the ones that spit on him, the soldiers that mocked him and dressed him up and beat him with a reed, he went through so much. And hanging on that cross, he said, Father, forgive them.
Thank you, Lord.
The love that he must have for us,
amen,
is unbelievable.
Amen.
I would do it injustice to try to describe his love tonight. But he says he wants us to forgive each other. He wants us to come together, church. We're in the last days. And the message of the cross is forgiveness. It's always been forgiveness. Getting forgiveness and giving forgiveness.
Amen.
I was reading over in Matthew 18 before this revival started. And God showed me where there was this king. Many of you know the story. And this man owed him so much. Millions. And he came before the king. And the king said, it's time to pay up. You are a great debt. And the man fell down. He said, I beg for mercy. The Bible says the king had mercy on him. And get this, he didn't say, well, we're going to set up a payment plan. I'm going to charge you some interest. We'll back. We'll refinance you. No, he didn't say that. He said, you're forgiven.
Thank you, Lord.
That's what Jesus done for you today if you're saved.
That's right.
But then that same man, church, the same man that was forgiven, is the church, not lost, but church, your debt's forgiven. Went over to brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so and grabbed them by the throat.
Yeah.
Pay up the pennies that you owe me. And the Bible says that the king heard of it. The other servants saw it. The other church members said, hey, let's go tell the king. And they went and told the king. And the Bible says the king was furious. He demanded that the debt be paid in full at that point. And then it says the same thing. I want to read this. Lord, let me turn to it. It says, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if you from your hearts forgive not everyone his brother their trespasses.
Thank you, Lord.
Don't miss the heart's part. God looks at the heart. Jesus said they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. I forgive them, but bless God, I don't want to see them. I hope I don't pass them on the road and have to wave at them. I hope they don't even sit beside me in church. I hope I don't have... That's not forgiveness, folks. That's lip service.
Come on,
you forgive from the heart. You forgive.
Yeah, right.
You forgive. And you know how you forgive? When you think about the cross. I know it's so simple. I know y'all were going to... I wish he quit beating it. It's simple. When you think about what Jesus done on the cross, you can't be you can't have unforgiveness in your heart. You can't look at someone and say, you don't deserve my forgiveness after what Christ has done for you.
Amen.
That's the power of the gospel. You don't earn it. You can't deserve it, as I mentioned. You can't even keep it. He says, I'm the author and finisher of your faith. He said, I've sealed you to the day of redemption.
Amen.
So why would you hold a grudge?
That's right.
Why would you? How arrogant is it to hold a grudge? How proud, prideful is it to hold a grudge?
Amen.
Amen.
Think about it. I had a man offend me one time, and I'll share a little bit about what he done, but I don't want to say too much because I have nothing against him. I love the man. I don't want to think I'm hashing it up. But I don't think he carries a Christian. Some things went down, and I didn't think he handled a money situation the right way. I'll leave it like that. Well, I was offended. Really more offended because he was a brother, not just a standard guy to me. I took him as a brother, and he still is. But time went on, and the more time went on, the more I felt like he owed me an apology. And I said, get him, God. Tear his tail up. Let him know. He better come to me. Every time I see him, he's happy as he can be, having his best day. And I'd say, I can't believe it. One day I'm coming from Wilmington, and on 74, and God says, you're going to call him and you're going to apologize right now. And I said, no.
No, no.
But you know what God tells you to do. You know.
Do it.
You know. And I said, okay, Lord, but he will not answer his phone when he sees my number. Because when he saw me, even though he was happy, I could tell that he was kind of like, hope you don't bring up that. You know what I'm saying? He answered on the second ring. Hello? I said, brother such and such, I said, I want to apologize to you for the way I have felt about you over the situation, and I rehashed the situation. I said, I owe you an apology because I have held a grudge against you. And I don't have no liberty and freedom because I'm holding that grudge. And when I said that, it just felt like it was just coming off of me. And I thought, oh,
praise
Lord,
God,
that's
it.
But get this now, get this. He goes, I thought he's going to break down crying and say, oh, brother, I'm sorry. Do you know what he said? He says, I forgive you. He said, I look over that stuff. And I was like, he says, but you know what? When I hung up, I had peace.
That's
Amen.
It.
Amen.
That's what it's all about.
Forgiveness.
Amen. Whatever went on with him, that's between him and God. I'm good, and he's
set
good
free.
With me. Matter of fact, I've seen him. He don't even probably know all the later of this, I'm telling. But I have nothing against the man. He'll never know it. If he was sitting here tonight, he wouldn't even know. I have nothing against him. But I don't know what God done with him. That's none of my business.
That's
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Forgiveness is giving someone something they don't deserve.
That's right.
They don't deserve it.
Yeah.
But it's for your peace. It's for your forgiveness.
Yes.
Power.
Now, there's been some things happening in our community. It's the elephant in the room nobody wants to talk about most of the time. But the truth of the matter is, if we could ever just come together in unity, man, we could blow this community up.
Woo.
Amen.
Amen.
Loving each other, supporting each other.
That's right.
Me and Brother G.C. they even talked about, why don't we try to get organized a choir amongst all the churches and call it the revival choir. And then whoever's having a revival, what a great idea.
Amen.
That's his idea. I can't take credit for that. That's the kind of things we need to think, y'all, because the lost is out there
unified,
looking at us.
Amen.
And they don't see Jesus a lot of times. They see a bunch of mad, hypocritical people.
Mm.
They get mad and do this and do that. I think it was someone told me there's 14 churches in Bladenboro within the city limits. 14. If you can't get saved in Bladenboro, you can't get saved nowhere. 14. But you know what it really says? People just don't get along.
Yeah, that's right.
It says they can't forgive each other.
That's the truth.
That's what it says. I travel around the country. I've been in West Missouri and up in Baltimore and Alabama. That's about as far in between. And, you know, I'm going to tell you, it's an anomaly here in our town. It's different here.
Amen.
It ain't like this everywhere. Can I get an amen? Somebody
amen. Amen.
We're religious here. We're very religious people. There's people, I mean, it's just different. And it would do us all good tonight to examine our hearts.
Amen.
And see what in the world is going on with me. Because God has not moved in this revival like he wants to move. And it's not because of a bad preaching, which I admit I'm not the best preacher. It ain't because we didn't have good singing. It's because people just don't want to humble themselves and get right.
Amen.
Amen.
If you'll get right, God will start moving.
That's
Amen.
Right.
That's the bottom line.
Amen.
That's the bottom line. True forgiveness will be from the heart. An unforgiving spirit says, you're basically saying, hey, I'm sitting on the throne of my own heart. God, I'm going to do it my way. When you have an unforgiving spirit. We need to get back to get that peace. Jesus says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives you, unto you let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. The peace of God surpasses all understanding.
Yes.
That peace cannot be bought. You can't put a price on the peace of God. When you don't have peace with God, you're a miserable human being. I don't care how much money you got. I don't care how many girlfriends you got. I don't care about whatever it is that floats your boat. If you don't have peace with God, you're a miserable person.
Amen.
Most people today that are rich and you see and people look up to them, they have no peace. They have no peace. They keep wanting more and more because they're trying to fill that void that only Jesus can fill. And the cross is how you come to that place of fulfillment. You come to the foot of the cross, you humble yourself, and you say, Lord, I have nothing to offer you but myself. Lord, forgive me.
Testify.
Take this bitterness out of me. Take this unforgiveness out of me. Lord, I don't want it in me no more. Take it. I can't get rid of it. I can't do it. You know what? If you could do it, then he wouldn't have had to die for you. He's got to do it, but you have to surrender your will to him.
Amen.
And he'll take that root of bitterness and snatch it right out of your heart.
That's it. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
He owed the king a great debt. We all have owed God a great debt. We'll probably spend the first 10,000 years just praising him for the great debt he delivered us from.
Amen.
Think about that. David said, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings, and he hath put a new song in my mouth.
Thank you.
Even praise unto our God. Many shall see it in fear and shall trust in the Lord. That's us. If we get a spring in our step and a praise in our lips and we quit being unforgiving, God, the people will see that and say, man, there's something different about that crowd. Mm-hmm. They ain't like the what I heard about that. They got something real here. I want to know what it is.
Amen.
And then they'll get a hold of that thing and change their life.
Amen.
Amen.
For innumerable evils have come to me about, my iniquities have taken hold of me so that I am not able to look up. There are more than the hairs of my head. Therefore, my heart faileth me. He was saying, I have so many iniquities, I can't even number them. But yet, God will forgive you for every one. He says, if you'll confess your sins, he'll faithful and just to forgive you of all sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. It's not by works which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Lord. That servant wouldn't forgive the other servant. He thought that it was too much for him to give mercy. And then we see how the king turned and took judgment on the servant. But the Bible says, Jesus said, blessed are the merciful, for they shall have mercy. They shall receive mercy. If you don't give mercy, God's not going to give you mercy. He says his mercies are renewed every morning. That means as bad as you mess up, the very next morning God's renewed his mercy. But you have to be merciful.
Thank you.
You have to give mercy.
Help us, Lord.
He said, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. How many people have grieved the Spirit of God in revivals?
Oh,
how many people have grieved the Spirit of God in just a regular church service?
Mm.
Grieving the Spirit of God is not being obedient to the Lord, to the Spirit. When he's moving on you, you need to act. You need to move then. And when you don't, you grieve him. He's a person. He's not an it. He's part of the Trinity. He is Jesus to us. Christ is sitting on the right hand of glory. He sent the Spirit of God back. He's the one that comes in our hearts and regenerates us and makes something dead and stinking alive and new to God.
And
gives us power. Walking in power and great victory and glory in Jesus Christ. That's the Spirit of the living God. He's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He's something that there's nothing that can push or come against him. When the enemy comes in, the evil comes in, the Bible says he'll lift up a standard against the enemy. He's got all the power. He can do anything in your life, but you've got to surrender your will and let him have it. And here's a scripture that bothers me. I want to read this. The Lord wanted me to read this tonight in Hebrews 10. It says, for if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for our judgment, fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. Now look, I'm not going to go into the philosophical part of this, but if you sin willfully, the Bible says there remains no more sacrifice. I didn't say that's what the Bible just said. If you have unforgiveness in your heart tonight, it is a willful sin and an act of your will to harbor that and not give forgiveness. Jesus said, unless you're forgiven, my Father won't forgive you. How much clearer do I need to make it? You can play with your soul. You can play with the fact that you think, you know, you can just get by. God will not turn a blind eye. He will not ignore sin. It must be dealt with. It was serious enough that his son went to the cross for you, and you're going to have to receive that forgiveness on this side, or you will have no forgiveness. When you step out into eternity, you're either going to step out, and Jesus is going to say, he's one of mine, she's one of mine, they're bought with my blood, Father, or he's going to say, look, I don't know them. I don't know this person. Depart from me, you work of iniquity. I never knew you.
Amen.
Does that bring fear to anyone tonight?
Amen.
A lot of people don't want to talk about that. They don't want to believe that. There's coming a great separation. Jesus called it that day. That day. The judgment. The judgment's coming. That's why revival is so important. That's why I get so worked up about revival. I say, God, send real revival. Lord, let something really happen. Don't let it just be a bunch of meetings. I don't want to be there if it's going to be that. I want to see you move. Why? Because I want to run up down the aisle? No, because I want to see the power of God.
Amen.
He's coming back.
Amen.
The next thing on his prophetic calendar is to split the eastern sky, and the people are going to bust up out of the grave, just been saved, and they're going to go up into heaven, and us that are alive will be caught up with them together, and forever we'll be with the Lord.
Amen.
But there's going to be people left behind. Some of you are going to have family members left behind. Some of your friends are going to be left behind. Your coworkers, your neighbors are going to be left behind.
Great.
Amen.
Because you were too stinking unforgiving to get that cleaned up out of your heart so you can be a witness to them. How are you going to explain yourself to the Lord?
Right.
Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it.
Amen.
God will clean you up. He'll set you free tonight. You can have liberty. When you walk out of that door, you don't have to go out the way you come in. You don't have to hide that unforgiveness and harbor that ill will. You can be set free today.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. But you need to come.
Amen.
You need to come to Him. And you need to lay it on the altar. You know who I'm talking to? I don't have nobody in mind tonight. But God does. He had you on His mind before you were born.
Amen.
He knew everything about you intimately. He knew what you were going to face. He knew the problems. He knew the people were going to offend you. God knows everything. And He sent me here tonight to tell you that if you'll simply humble yourself and ask Him to forgive you, He will forgive you and lift that burden off of you.
Thank you, Lord.
That man right there, my friend, saw his partner gunned down in front of him. And he forgave him. It took a lot. But God worked through him. Who in the world in here has seen her partner gunned down? Somebody said something to you, hurt your feelings? Somebody hurt you at church? He sent a man shoot his partner down in cold blood and forgive him. If he can forgive, to be sure you can forgive.
Amen.
Amen.
Sister Barbara. Now I know this weren't a celebration. May is the last Bible message. This is what God told me to preach. I had no idea who would be here other than the choir, this visiting choir. Somebody here needs to get it right tonight. If you don't, it's between you and the Lord. It's all for me. But tonight is the night. You come and make it right tonight. You unload that unforgiveness. You unload that guilt. And you let God have it. And I promise you, you'll walk out of here and something's going to change in your life. God is going to move mightily in your life.
Amen.
And altars open. Stand with me, please.
Thank you, Lord.
You come. This message was for you. You step out and come.
Just as I am. Never.